Welcome to the third round of NEAO 2017. My name is Bunny. With me, I have Yuto and Chris. In opening government, we have HKU. In opening opposition, we have SDS1. In closing government, we have HYDS1. And in closing opposition, we have BFSU2. On the motion, this House regrets motherhood as an intrinsically fulfilling experience, or something to that effect, I call upon Prime Minister Kiefer.
Motherhood is an idea that came out of conservative parties advancing the oppression of women, and the fact that many women also engaged in a self-fulfilling prophecy telling themselves that it's entirely okay to stay home and take care of the children and revolve your life around it, we think it's extremely problematic. It disempowers women, it oppresses them, and we oppose it. What do we mean by this narrative? We say in all fact, the motherhood narrative that motherhood is intrinsically fulfilling, mainly surrounds, is mainly perpetuated in movies, in ads, advertisements, etc., mainly perpetuating the idea that oftentimes, for example, behind a man usually there is a woman behind him, behind a great man usually a mother is cultivating them. And the fact that this narrative usually tells us that being a mother, you need to bear and tolerate all of the consequences indiscriminately during the raising of your children, and you will derive joy out of these very painful experiences. And ultimately, the most gratifying part about all of this experience related to motherhood is seeing your kid succeed. We think these are very problematic on several levels, because we think, firstly, that motherhood is not an intrinsically fulfilling experience. Secondly, it is damaging to the mothers, and thirdly, it is damaging to familial relationships. We're going to separate these things. But first of all, back to a very basic question. What is motherhood? We think that motherhood ultimately is an idea that you need to tolerate and you need to tolerate many grievances that you're raising as a child. This usually, on paper, it sounds like something that is really like very, very grand and very sacrificial. But at the center of the motherhood, you are asking for mothers to not just sacrifice a part of their life, you're asking them to let this duty as a mother dominate over her entire life. So we're talking about dominating, say, for example, her social circles, because now that you are taking care of your child full time, your social circles also automatically revolve around your child, so you meet other parents in the school. You also say, for example, the mother needs to always take care and worry about the children. And so ultimately, why is this bad? Because we think that this is sometimes something that mothers tell themselves to make themselves better. This is really a coping mechanism that mothers come up with themselves, right? We think this is exactly the textbook definition of a psyche level of oppression. Because we think that it is something that is the most prominent form of oppression against women is the fact that you can ask women to think that they are really their best abilities are really to cater for the children to stay at home. So we think that this idea ultimately is very toxic. Because ultimately, it tells you that you need to sacrifice, that it's perfectly fine for you to sacrifice a career and to stay home, without recognizing that probably the career path is much better for you, and you can probably achieve a lot more. We say this is also bad because you are unable to examine whether a career path, make a rational choice about whether a career path is better for you or whether raising a child is better for you, because one side of choice is hugely glamorized under the current status quo. Because of this, we think it's a bad thing for mothers to self-empower themselves. More importantly, we say, on a more practical level, the damage that it does to mothers is also very problematic. The problem with this is that it's not just about the values that lie at the center of motherhood. It's also about how mothers usually perceive these values. So we are saying that, yes, we agree that sometimes sacrifices can be very glamorous. We agree that sometimes sacrifices can be good. But we think that the idea of motherhood asks for a disproportionate contribution from mothers to contribute to the well-being of their children. This means that oftentimes mothers will be able to use motherhood as an excuse to defend against people who say they have been oppressed or they have been asked too much by their husbands. This also means that within a family where power dynamics is hugely imbalanced, we say the breadwinner can always shift the responsibility onto the mothers by saying, look, you are supposed to make sacrifices for your family. There really is no limit to the sacrifices that we can make, and therefore you take every single responsibility in rearing your life.
So if we're talking about oppressive and conservative families where women do not have a higher status or equal status with their husbands, why do you have to take away their sense of pride and sense of fulfillment when they're already in disadvantage?
Okay, first of all, we're not just talking about oppressive conservative families, we're talking about sort of families in general, because we think that this is psyche level oppression that happens every single place. Right? So we're not just talking about very conservative families. Liberal families can also be subjected to this, because ultimately, again, because of the very glamorized nature of one particular choice that is becoming mother for the child. So they need to keep up their attitude. But more importantly, right, we think, so their point is more important, and we also want to talk about this actually. When a mother actually chooses to become a mother, what's bad about it? We think it's already a very skewed choice. They ultimately really ask them not to go out to work because you need to make sacrifices. So in family relations, it's probably bad. But finally, we also want to talk about another very important stakeholder in this debate, that is children. Because think motherhood, the primary target of motherhood is about caring about children. So for example, the things that you do for your child to develop them, say asking them to go to certain interest class, to learn to play the piano, to learn to play basketball. The problem with this is the idea of being fulfilling is that you need to ask your children to do things and achieve things that you think are fulfilling to yourself. You are living your life through your children and imposing what you think is the best for them onto the child. Why is that different from any sort of parental expectation that we impose on children? Because we think that ultimately, this usually concerns the choices that a child is perfectly capable to make. That is to say, if the child is very interested in playing basketball, but the mother thinks that there is really no future for playing basketball, then she will at all costs push the child and pressure the child to do something that he doesn't like, and we don't disagree, and we don't agree that the child is incapable of making a choice about his interests. So therefore, the problem with this is that you are harming the chances for children to develop, and at the same time, you're imposing this unnecessary pressure on children to grow up in a particular way. The more important thing about this argument is that you also need to recognize that mothers are not perfectly rational agents, in that they always judge what is best for their children according to what society wants. So if society demands that you learn an instrument to survive, then the mother will pressure the children to also learn an instrument. We think that in these cases, because it is an irrational choice, because we advocate the rights of the mother and the well-being of the children, very proud to support.
Thank you, Prime Minister, for that speech. To begin the case, the opposition, leader of opposition, Kenya.
Glamorization of pregnancy, if it can make a better outcome, why not? We think it is actually right for us to continuously push that idea and that narrative. And generally, we feel like opening government were quite against one type of parenting style. And secondly, when they talk about, like, for example, if they were trying to exaggerate how this parenting and having babies too, like, always like bad choice that women can possibly make. But we think it is absolutely wrong. Idea is subjective at best. And furthermore, even if it is true, we think it is still have to change. Even if we concede and like even if we think that it is some degree, like it will make a pain and stuff, like what they said, we still think it has to be changed, and I think opening opposition will able to make that change. This debate is made most sense, we think, and make most possible impact when we actually talk about the woman who is actively want to be a mother in the status quo. We will likely be going to talk about, number one, why this empowers the mother, and number two, how do you recognize the mother's, how do you recognize the motherhood better? For clarification, when we think this intrinsic fulfillment, the counter of the intrinsic means we think it's external fulfillment from under our side of case, meaning that external fulfillment, including such as, like, for example, like all the hospital that provide from the external government, or like better like choice, better husband, or more monetary status. We think it is this kind of external forces, external factors are included in external fulfilling factors. But the comparatively, what we are advocating is the true choice, the intrinsic, all based choice that women are make. For example, like value, like true value of choice, like all the sacrifice or all the pains that this woman has to go through. We think this has to be validated under without any other circumstance or external factors included in judging and validating that particular sacrifice of the woman. We think it is the right respective forms that empowering the woman in the end of the day. From first argument, why is it empowering women? So we think is we giving a optimal choice that woman can make, meaning that if we continuously validate how this woman are making a right choice, even if these women are not having even if it is wrong choice, still we think it is absolutely making sense, because we are respecting that woman's particular choice. Rather, they will likely going to condemn and make a lot of excuses that this woman are making a wrong choice, because they are continuously making that choice that woman made is wrong, because they think it is absolutely wrong ideas to make a pregnancy under their system. And not because external factors, we are likely going to highlight this woman's are actually having a hard time and agony to make sure they are contributing within the society. That is when the society recognize and people recognize this is a true value that we have to embrace and respect. If they don't respect that particular value, and because they think it is wrong choice, who are likely going to advocate and support for that particular choice? Because that choice that they have been mentioned is so wrong, and nobody will likely going to say, oh, that is quite good choice, please do so. Nobody will likely going to actively support that. And it leads to our second argument. Why is it likely going to empower the motherhood? We think it's particularly important. If you see the reform, and we need to give as much as more rights for women, and we think its current status is the momentum that we are actually have to make it that right choice. Meaning that when we start to give it respect, all other, like for example, like organization, women supporter institution, they are actually concerning about this particular issue, and they may be they also know it is particularly harmful, a particularly sacrifice and a tired job that woman has to bear. We think it's particularly important when they validate that particular choice, and they think it is, if they think this is wrong choice, the institution or organization will easily going to say, oh, we are not going to support that because that is wrong choice that women shouldn't make. We think it's particularly harmful when women, especially in the most vulnerable situation, as they describe all the vulnerable situation, all irrational status, they will unlikely going to get any support from other institutions that has to be worked extremely hard to garner help to garner all different types of, like, for example, external factors as well. This particular why we also can, in the end, actually garner all the external support as well, because the institution have the legitimacy to argue that this is particularly right choice. Intrinsically, the woman made a good choice. This is why this woman have legitimacy to get all the supports from under our side of the world.
Even if you get all the external help that you would like to argue, if everyone's going to be deceived that this is a right notion, how do you liberalize women?
The thing is, it's absolutely not making sense, because I don't think every single person will likely going to make that wrong choice. And I think mother has ability to choose whether that is particularly right or wrong, because they know, because what we are advocating is we want to give the choice that women as only based on their, without the external factors, solely based on like their body function or their current mindset or mentality, these kind of things we think is perfectly okay for the women to make choice as well. And what this means is, as soon as we give them a choice, and we give them a, we validate that choice is something that is right, it's very easy for these women to also opt out in the beginning. That is why it is hard for harmful governments to forcibly force those women to get pregnant, meaning that women will likely going to have this particular choice is valid, but that choice has, that nobody is actively going against that particular choice, but at the same time, you give diverse choice rather than you are giving a one only choice, because anyway, the woman will likely going to make that choice solely based on her own body status or all other, like, her own value. We think it is easier for these women to legitimize her option or her choice from on the outside of this. We think absolutely giving a right choice for women is way better for these women to garner and getting support and making, finally getting a reform, even if that this choice may be bad, but still in the end of the day, we think it is far more better for this society to move on and really care about this woman are actually making a good choice, and that choice can be supported from the all the other organizations or even including widely from the site. When that happened, we think it is when this mother who really want to be a mother will be finally supported from the society. Thank you very much.
The term intrinsically fulfilling implies that motherhood itself is fulfilling, even if you have no meaningful career, even if you have no meaningful social circles outside the social circles you're afforded by your children, even if you have no personal life or independent life, that you still feel that it's fulfilled. If you're talking about a rich, powerful CEO who's happy with having kids and is happy with a family, that's not a contentious issue in the debate. Rather, that's the kind of image we promote under our side of the house, where we say just having kids isn't fulfilling, but you'd also try to maximize your independence by also going out and having a career. Rather, this is a regrets motion because it denies women something, and what we pointed out from PM is that it denies women the chance to break through centuries of conservative and patriarchal thought that as a woman, you do not deserve to be in a workplace, you do not need to be working outside and have a social life, you should stay at home, you should be with your kids, and you should be content and fulfilled with the life you're allowed to have. That is the lie we have pointed out from you from PM. So how can we not regret a narrative that teaches women to be content with the entrenched lives that they have been socially taught to have? We reject the free choice ideas. We're going to respond to that directly later. So we claim to you that it's a lie that this inherently is fulfilling, that to have a life you have to live through your children is intrinsically fulfilling when you have no freedom, especially after your children leave at age of 60, no career, no actual social circle. Then how is that really a fulfilling life? Because we need to point out here is that at certain times in your life, even if this is a lie you believe and gives you comfort, there are times when that lie is shattered. When you see friends who come from more liberal circles, when you see people who are not married and have successful careers, who are actually independent from the finances of their husbands, can make choices that affect their life every moment of the day, then your lie about you being fulfilled with only being a mother is shattered. And at those points, you say there's an ultimate harm that we regret, that it is not about how you have no choice but to be a mother, and we should protect these kind of people. So what do we say to you today? Two responses that kick all out of this debate. Firstly, they have this generic idea about how this debate is about suddenly in this world everyone starts hating people who are mothers without careers. That's not what this debate is about. This is a regrets motion, therefore we are considering a world in which we never had the narrative that as a mother you should only be a mother or be fulfilled with being a mother and you should also try to go on and work. So that kind of like limits a lot of the arguments that we're trying to make about how hatred towards mother. But the second level was again this kind of idea of choice, but they only talk about choice in like how it's a free choice, how it's like a valid choice. Two ways we think we should examine choice in a regrets motion. Firstly, whether or not this is a really a free choice, and secondly, whether it's a good choice. Because we are regretting something, we regret it if it wasn't free, or ultimately a better choice than it would have been without this kind of thing.
Firstly, we don't think they can argue choice without ever responding to the kind of narratives that we've already pointed out from private speech. Like, the most famous, recently famous Olympic ads are about how, like, these Olympians had mothers who sacrificed for them, like, worked through the day, and had to, like, sacrifice their careers so that these people could be famous in the Olympics. And everyone loved those ads. But those are the very narratives that entrench in the mind of a woman that you do not necessarily have to work, that if someone tells you that you should stay at home, you're less likely to fight against these kind of norms or oppressions, because you're okay with the idea that this is a fulfilling life. As long as my kid is an Olympian, that's absolutely fine. We've already flagged to you why this is a harm to the family unit as a whole, because these are unrealistic expectations that women have when they're trying to live their lives to other people. So ultimately, we don't really think this is a free idea or an idea that is unregrettable, because it is an idea that is very tainted with centuries of oppression behind that idea. Secondly, is this a good idea? Is it ultimately good? Is it ultimately fulfilling to be a mother in itself? Here's why that's not true. We already pointed out to you, no response, that the counterfactual here is that if you are not only fulfilled with being a mother, you're also more likely to go into a job place and be financially independent. So why is it important for you to have a career as an independent person? It means that two things happen to you. Firstly, you become financially independent, and secondly, you become socially independent. You become independent from the factors that can drastically change your life. That one day your husband leaves you, one day you find out your husband is an alcoholic, abusive, that your husband is cheating on you, that your kids have left for college and don't want to call home anymore. At those moments, when your life is no longer fulfilling, when your life has to have some kind of direction, without an actual career to base the rest of your life on, it's ultimately a very harmful choice for these people. Because you are happy until the moment your life breaks, and those breaks do happen. It happens all the time when mothers realize that their husband is being abusive, but they stay with the husband for their children instead of thinking about their own personal life and realizing, I have to be financially independent, I have to put the foot down and say, this is where it ends, I'm going to be my own person. So what do we think is the important thing to recognize in this debate? What happens when we recognize that this is a regrets motion, and what kind of social things happen in response? Firstly, a world without this, right, NEPOIs, a world without this isn't suddenly where everyone suddenly thinks mothers are terrible, but in a world that had read for this all the time, it's a world where women individually push for more freedom, that even if there are narratives that women belong in the house, because it's never really fulfilling to them, and as you've already characterized from Brian's speech, that it's also a self-fulfilling prophecy, that they're conditioning themselves to not feel bad about their situation. They're also less likely to go out and demand that they're allowed to work, less likely to fight against their parents, or fight against social norms that tell them their place in the household is to be happy where they are. But secondly, it's also within the household. We think this isn't just about how it's impossible for women, therefore this is a norm that we're okay with, because ultimately it benefits them, but it's also because a lot of the time, the reason why women are not financially independent or don't go in the workplace is because they've already been conditioned by the media or conditioned by this culture that it's okay for them to have a fulfilling life that is devoid of any actual job or devoid of any actual meaningful social circles or interactions. Meaning, the narrative doesn't really have to be absolute, but you allow it to be absolute by never raising the issue with your husband who might listen to you. You never resolve the conflict by talking to your parents who may be more supportive of you if they knew how devastated you were by the fact that your life is defined by a child who doesn't necessarily do everything you command them to do. Finally, what do we think? What about the cases where there's inability of you to change your movements? Like, even if this wasn't a regrets motion, or like, in our case, what about those specific circumstances that POI raised? Two responses. Firstly, you can largely ignore that. This is about like regrets motion, so like social norms, how they would develop up to this point. And secondly, we claim to you that it's better than living a lie at the end. Because we've already pointed out to you that this is not an absolute lie, that if you become a mother in an oppressive situation, that you're not ultimately always happy with being a mother until the moment you die. There are moments in your life when that lie is shattered, when you meet a friend who is actually free from all those kind of oppressions, when you meet someone who is financially independent, when your husband leaves you, your husband is cheating on you, abuses you, your child leaves you, doesn't care about you anymore. There are all of these moments in your life where you realize your life is not perfect because you got a kid and because you're a mother. Your life is only perfect because you independently made those decisions and because you have the financial independence and the social independence to make decisions retroactively in life when things weren't so great. Thank you.
you were to go back in time and imagine a world in which you would still have very oppressive countries, or you would still have quite liberal, quite progressive, but still bigoted and conservative societies, or you would still have patriarchal societies even in the most developed areas, we think that government must prove that even if you were to go back in time in these societies, you would suddenly have reforms for women to make good choices. You would suddenly now decrease the pressure on women who genuinely want to be mothers. Because on their side, what happens is that you would still have societal pressures. You would still have a patriarchal family that would force you to say that you must be a mother because that is what defines you. Then the debate must be that we must prove how these reforms for those who, A, do not have any other choice but to be a mother, would be now having a more optimal choice by making reforms by the government, or B, they must prove how, why women would now be able to have the power and the choice to opt out from these types of narratives. We do not think that the government was able to do that. So why then? Because ultimately, we think that you must buy the characterization from my partner when they said that the only depiction that you have will take you towards these women is that you would either demonize them and say that this is a bad choice, but B, and we think that it's the most like dangerous thing is that you would have the same privileged individuals who can make a compromise, have a career and be a mother at the same time and say that these are the perfect choices. That cannot happen in any world because you still would have individuals in the most underprivileged and the most vulnerable areas to make a trade-off. And we think that forced trade-off is particularly harmful because government does not change that. So the biggest question is, what are they going to do once women should make a trade-off and should make a choice? No, thank you. What then is the difference coming from opposition side? We tell you that just because it is an intrinsic fulfillment doesn't necessarily mean that we should depict it as a bad choice. Because what Nijin tells you that it's actually possible. For to say that being a mother is something that's difficult. Being a mother means that you have costs, that there are risks. But the difference is that despite all these risks, you are making a valid choice. You are making a difficult choice. And we think that recognition is particularly powerful. Because only when you say that the woman is making an independent choice, because the woman has calculated whether this choice fulfills herself, we think that's when you say that the woman is empowered, not because of external things. No, thank you. So under your side, you would still have a world in which your parents would be saying, oh, you have a good boyfriend who is rich, why aren't you getting married with him? Oh, you can have children, why aren't you getting married with him? Under our world, at the very least, even with the same society, a woman now has the power to think, am I intrinsically happy? Is this something that's valuable for my choice? We think that's a counter-narrative that we are able to have under our side. On the other side, we still have women who are making bad choices, who are non-feminist, who are gold diggers, and who are shallow. We think that's particularly more harmful. First response coming from opening government. We think they said that it's extremely bad because women now have used this as a coping mechanism. We should glamorize this type of idea. It's a psychic of oppression. And think, okay, speakers, please do not buy this narrative. Because the way they depict this is as if women are so dumb, so irrational.
Fabrication.
Because at the same breath, no thank you, they want to run away from this debate and say that it's not just conservative families. So I do not know what exactly is the country in which you do not guarantee any bare minimum right. No thank you, for a woman to at least understand that there are different choices existing. So what this means is that even if you have a glamorized world, if you have depictions, as you said, that you're going under a Western or a very democratic state, then we assume that there are also different narratives existing. No, thank you. But even if, let's say, we were to bite the bullet and this is the dominating narrative, why do we then think that it is good? Because the biggest problem with these very liberal countries is that they force women to believe that this is a choice that you must not make because you have to be career women. We think that's particularly horrible. No, thank you. Because in the end, it's the same society pressuring women and saying that this is a good choice and this is a bad choice. Let's go back and just imagine, when was the last time in which we actually told a woman to think whether or not this actually fulfills herself? We think this is a very liberal narrative in which we change things, which finally we say that being a mother isn't based on how much money you have, isn't based on what type of husband you have. These aren't external values anymore. And that's why we have better reform systems in which governments are more incentivized to make sure that women are able to make that choice. Yes. No, thank you, because at least on the very end, women now have better calculation and rationality to believe that maybe this is a choice for myself. If they do not think that they're going to be fulfilled because it's not intrinsically for them, that personal choice is also in which we allow like for them to opt out from it. And we think that should also exist. No, thank you. They're doing an unfair debate here as if women are powerless and women do not have a thinking capability. So the second question, and this is the most important thing, will the intrinsic fulfillment narrative diminish any form of rational capability of a woman to make choice? So I said a lot of these things, but we think that this is a big difference, right? I told you that just because it's intrinsically fulfilling doesn't necessarily mean that we diminish the difficulties a woman should face. So what did Minjun tell you? Minjun tells you the spectrum in which we evaluate how women are being shown. The previous speaker tells us that the way we see it is that women are doing all of these things, they're sacrificing themselves, we should validate them. Imagine a world in which that does not exist. What happens? They think that being a mother is something that is obvious.
something that has no fulfillment. Even if it's not, even if it does not have any fulfillment, it is something that you must do as a woman. This is very bad because on the comparative, we have a narrative that says that it's something that can make you happy, and if a woman does not feel happy, that's when they allow better reevaluation, especially in areas in which women do not have that information. So on their side, you now have the only narrative that says that this is something unobvious. We do not care if you are not fulfilled because that's something you must do. An obligation now is in place to a woman, and we think that's particularly harmful. No, thank you. Second thing now, why do we then create a forceful trade-off under government model? Because this is what they said. They want this perfect world in which women are CEOs. Women now have jobs. Women can go to Samsung and everywhere. And then at the same time, women should not be mothers because it suddenly oppresses you so much. No, thank you. We think this is A, very exclusive. Why? A feminist movement or in any women movement, we think intersectionality is extremely important. What does this mean? Let me give you an example. Feminist movement before thought that being a porn star or going into the pornography industry was extremely bad. Exclusionary, the moment they excluded these women, did we change anything? No, because they realized that what you did was when you left these women to be the most vulnerable individuals in which they would not have better legal reform systems. How do we change this? What happens now is that rather than a world on the government side in which you say, oh, you're a woman, if you don't have a choice, since you're not privileged, since you cannot make a trade-off, you can just stop being a woman and you're not fulfilled. You are as unhappy, you are forced, and you're a bad feminist, you're making a bad choice. Under the comparative, what we do is that we actually acknowledge these women and say that you are actually making a difficult choice, you made that, and you should be fulfilled because you must be recognized for it. The recognition guarantees and helps them to make that choice. We think that's the difference, because the moment in which we accept and say that it's a good choice, that's when society is more incentivized to support a good choice. Why? Because under their side, you now don't have any reforms because society tells them that this is a bad choice. What is then their incentive to make any types of reform systems to ensure that mothers will have safety nets in which mothers are happy? None, because now they feel it's a bad choice under the worst case scenario of government side. So we think that the moment in which we support people who genuinely want to be mothers is not by excluding them, but in supporting them and making sure that they have diverse choices by reforming these systems and granting support by society. We do not think that happens on the government side. Do not believe they're suing the world progressive ideas. We're extremely proud to post these.
Madam Speaker, a fundamental fault coming from the opening house debate in today is essentially that they decide that what's best for women themselves. One, opening government, and just think, no, being a career woman is probably better for women, having a social circle is better for women, not having children might be better for women, as well as opening opposition who think that being a mother might be the best option for women. From closing government, we fundamentally reject this premise that there is a lot of expert that at the end of the day, decision of what's best for them needs to be left within that individual, right?
Sure, yeah.
The problem coming from opening opposition is that they seem to believe that without this narrative of motherhood being intrinsically fulfilling and therefore leading to self-actualization in the most accessible and best form, without this narrative, suddenly now women are going to be demonized by the feminist community and whatnot. We think that there is a certain appreciation as they talk about in terms of overcoming difficulty with or without this idea of a motherhood, that humanity as a whole generally appreciates the idea of a people overcoming difficulty. We think that there should be a certain level of appreciation for motherhood that should exist on both sides of the house, Madam Speaker. Therefore, the fundamental question in this debate was what kind of role did this kind of narrative play
in terms of entrenchment of gender role that essentially lock women away from progression and better development, better self-development, eventually leading to self-actualization, and also how this essentially became a tool of patriarchy to keep women out of the system, to keep women down and not being able to access whatever kind of opportunity and freedom that they fully and rightfully deserve as a human being. Couple responses. The ultimate line coming from opening opposition is that they want to empower these mothers, right? What they fail to understand is that, especially in these kind of conservative contexts where they want to talk about the most vulnerable stakeholders, right? A lot of mothers who also kind of subjected to, whether that be physical or psychological abuse in these kind of relationships are often forced into staying in that relationship because, if you divorce your husband and break apart your family because you were abused, you're being selfish. Why? Because you left your child out in the dry. We fundamentally think that this kind of narrative is harmful and disempowering for women, because at the end of the day, any kind of individual should be able to put their own personal well-being as a priority, right? They basically strip that power away from women and basically force them to sacrifice. We think that idea that this is forced, not choice, that's actually fundamentally flawed. Secondly, they talk about the idea of, you can't get a job and this kind of like, what will lead to career women and whatnot. We're going to tell you why this narrative specifically barred women, especially in these kind of conservative societies, from achieving economic sufficiency by getting a job and whatnot. Because the idea is that it's not about demonization of mother, or it's not about celebration of working women. It's more about balanced narrative, because we think that best choice can have best choice is an informed choice, where there's a relatively balanced counter-narrative that exists on status quo, that exists on both sides, right? On the other hand, in the status quo, we basically say being a mother is the most accessible and therefore the easiest way that women can achieve self-fulfillment, and that in and of itself we think is harmful. Now, opening government basically try to tell you why there's a mechanism of whatever. I'm going to tell you actual consequences of it. They basically tell you that it's wrong. It's wrong that women are stripped away from their social circle or career opportunities. We're going to tell you why this actually perpetuated the impact of this argument. This perpetuated patriarchy. Women in the end, they talk about how under government paradigm, there is no social movement that happened. What you have to understand is that this narrative in and of itself is a very, very barrier that bars women from collectivize and make a movement. You have to understand that social movement don't happen from happy people. It comes out from discontent people who are not happy about the situation they're in, right? What they tell you is that now women who are in this kind of, and then opening up, closing opposition, I think someone agrees with this from their POI, the idea that as a woman, because you're a mother, you're celebrated, you should feel good about yourself, and you shouldn't change the situation. Why is this especially harmful, Madam Speaker, is that we think to a collectivized movement, you need a couple of things. One, you need to be able to come up, you need to be able to talk to other people who are in similar situation, right? We think that often these women who are trapped in childbearing, do not strip away from social circles, do not have the kind of interactions that don't matter, kind of the infrastructure they need in order to collectivize. But furthermore, when you discourage these women from making a career, developing their own career, and I'm not talking about just people making choices between having a career or being a mother. I'm talking about even the mothers who are trying to do both, right? Why is it so? Because even in households where these women also work, which was the opening government's paradigm, was that it's like essentially still the responsibility of childbearing falls on women, because precisely of this narrative that you will probably be able to reach self-fulfillment by doing this even if you have a career. Because why? Because as I told you, this is the most accessible and most predominant form of self-fulfillment that women can reach. Why is that bad? At the end of the day, this traps women, especially in these communities, to collectivize and start a movement. Why is this so? Because sit down, madam. In the end, in the end, when you are led to childbearing, the idea is that now it specifies a gender role that happens within a household. Woman has to cook and take care of the family, whereas men go out and make the income for the household. What this does, it creates a disproportionate balance of power within that family dynamic. Why? Because the economic power, as we see in political sphere or socioeconomic sphere, economic power is power in and of itself, in terms of making decisions and whatnot. So when you strip these women and discourage women from pursuing these kind of economic activity by saying that you should be able to, you don't need these kind of career options, you can still reach self-fulfillment by raising a child. We think that in and of itself strips these women from opportunity and incentive to actually go out and work, and therefore strip them of the opportunity in order to actually mobilize and able to understand their situation. they tell you is that, you know, these women, because of the circumstances they're in, whether that be the societal norm or cultural norm that binds these women into these kind of roles, they should feel good about themselves, and that in and of itself is a benefit. We think that that's inherently a bad thing to argue, because at the end of the day, this is why we see slow progresses happening in these kind of communities where mothers are basically, where women are supposed to be mothers. This is why, for example, in these kind of countries, daughters, like young girls, are often discouraged from education. Why? Because in the end, you won't need education. Why? Because in the end, the most intrinsic and most accessible and the best way that you can reach self-fulfillment is by being a mother anyway. So why do you need education? These are exactly the narrative that strip these women from any opportunity to actually collectivize and form a movement and therefore create progress. Madam Speaker, it's not about we don't get to make choices as to what's best for women. We allow women to make their decision according to whatever balanced narrative that exists. Our side is the one that balanced the narrative. And also, we're the one that told you, and the reason why we regret this was the existence of this narrative was one in the best way that trapped women into this kind of situation, that perpetuates misogyny, perpetuates patriarchy, and therefore keep women down. Proud to propose.
We agree with most of the things that both of our government teams have talked about. We think that entrenchment of gender role is bad. We think that restricting women's choices and status quo in terms of the jobs that they can get, the types of jobs they can get, the payments that they can get, the study, is bad. But we think that the problem with this debate is that it never differentiates the difference between the narrative that women is great because they make sacrifices with families versus the narrative that we're actively promoting in this case as women are being a mother is intrinsically fulfilling experience. We think that kind of distinction gives way to this kind of, to the exclusive extension that from the total opposition that explains to you particularly what is the impact of empowering women by giving them this kind of choice, a legitimate choice of becoming a mother as a fulfilling experience for themselves. Why that's going to be to actually more active attitudes in terms of the lifestyle choices as well as career choices that we argue that necessarily going to be generated. But before that, several responses, right? Closing opposition talk about the entrenchment of gender role is problematic. We agree. But the problem is that what is the root cause of that? We think that this debate is particularly relevant to the first world countries, which has already accepted the formal equality in terms of society, for example, legal protection and anti-discrimination law. Our opening house nicely explained to you how this kind of narrative can empower women in the adverse situations, the communities that are conservative and bigoted, in that gives them a narrative that makes them see their life as fulfilling and feel good as well. But within the problem in status quo, is that even in the first world countries, or relatively developed countries, with this kind of liberal legislation, females haven't really eventually accept the fact that they have other choices other than females. Examples would be like, for example, girls usually outperform boys until college, but then suddenly the number drops when they go to, for example, enroll in master's degrees or colleges, because they consider themselves that that's the only way for them to have a legitimate lifestyle is become women. Become mothers of children. But we think particularly we need to look into the root cause of this kind of choices, which will be dealt with in my second. But secondly, opposition talk about how social changes come from discontent people. We agree. But the problem is that how do you generate this kind of momentum for people to support them, to support more liberal and more like open choices for women in terms of lifestyles? Within the problem is that a lot of women haven't accepted the idea that mothers are just one of the many choices that they have. And that's the exclusive benefit that we're going to have to actively promote the idea that being a mother is an intrinsically fulfilling experience. Sorry, later. Why do we think that is beneficial for the liberation of women to the next level? We're taking a status quo. it's not a comparative between there's no narrative of being a mother is good and something that women should do versus that there is a narrative women should become mothers. It's a narrative between which in the sales call, mothers are selfless, children-centered, family-centered, that necessarily makes women to make sacrifices in daily life versus the narrative that we are promoting on the opposition side as inherently, and it's not something that requires a sacrifice because itself is a good choice and self is a self-fulfilling, is an intrinsically fulfilling experience. Why do we say this? Because we think that currently the narrative, especially in most of the countries, is that women are great, but that is used to justify the sacrifices that women have to make in their daily lives for family members and for their children. In the sense that in order to justify that kind of sacrifices, that forced the woman to see that the way for them to gain social recognition is to accept and internalize that kind of cost, that impose upon them, because the premise of that kind of narrative is that intrinsically there's no intrinsic value of being a woman other than being their mother, other than the fact that you are unfortunately have this kind of reproductive organs that give birth to your children and carry on the family name. We think that kind of narrative is particularly harmful, but just briefly explaining, because it essentializes women to the extent that it forces them to internalize their own and to force them to receive themselves, consider themselves as women who are destined to be mothers of their children. That's particularly powerful. In the sense that this kind of narrative can be characterized being irrational, and that can give rise to the peer pressures around them, in the sense that it's something you have to do for the sacrifice you make, to sacrifice yourself for the greater good of the family and for society. We think that is also indoctrinated to the girls from a very early age of their life. We think that's particularly powerful. But secondly, why a world where the narrative of this being a mother is intrinsically fulfilling experience is good in the sense that it injects the agency into women's choices and the women's choices over their lives. Why do we say this? First of all, later, this kind of narrative is self-centered in a sense that promotes self-interest over your sacrifice you make to the community and to the members to begin with. In the sense that the reason you become a mother of a child or children is actually your active children, in the sense that being a mother is your own choice. But second level, in the sense that it also deglorifies the profession of being a mother. It is not something necessarily great that you should do, the sacrifice you have to make as the other gender of society to the community. It also equalizes, it has the potential to equalize all other kinds of choices in a sense that you should invite and provide this kind of exclusive metric and equalizing metric to evaluate the utility of different choices inclusively from the utility that brings to you, whether it increases the level of happiness for you as a woman. But before I move on to how does that change the calculation for women, go.
We're not saying that being a mother is bad, but that what is bad is believing being a mother is all you need to be happy because it reinforces the conservative narrative used to oppress women.
That's why they fail to realize this kind of nuances between the two sets of narratives, right? That is exactly what I want to explain to you now. How does that change the calculation of women to begin with? Because first of all, we think that in a sense that from the early beginning, you have a world where we have the dominance of this kind of narrative that motherhood is intrinsically self-fulfilling. We think in a sense that women are more likely to make choices that being mothers, they're going to consider motherhood as a equalized choices at other professions, as being a scientist, as being a CEO of a company, in a sense that it also brings a mother And within this also particular good, in a sense that if you make mother things that makes being a mother makes a woman happy, it actually makes good. It's also good for the parental relationship within the family. But thirdly and crucially, the message here is that we think that it also sends out the message that your life does not involve children. In a sense that if being a mother to a child and being the mother role within the family does not make you happy, you can walk away. In a sense that you're bringing a completely new measurement and metric towards the value of the meaning of life for you as a woman. In the sense that we hear, if you don't find the experience fulfilling, when your marriage fails, when you do not bring up a happy child, means sense that you demystify this experience of bringing up a child, meaning that it doesn't really make you happy, it doesn't make you intrinsically happy, you can walk away, you can have other kind of experiences, pursue a career, whatever, with that makes you happy. But in this case, it injects the crucial level of agency to the woman, allow them to experience the opportunities that has already been fought by the past generations of feminist movement in the society. For all those reasons, we're very proud to talk to you.
Thank you for the opposition for that speech. Thank you for the time. I apologize for the
CEO, you can't say that try being a mother. If it's not fit to you, you can walk away. You're moving away from your burden at that point. We need to understand that this debate is about what kind of narrative are we going to support. In the end, what's a better, more healthy, and a preferable narrative for societal environment, animals here, that we would rather want to live in. With that consideration, let's go on to three big questions that I want to go on to. Let's go on to the first one. I think this is why the open half was a deadlock and closing off is just pops on to open off. That kind of becomes therefore kind of being boxed out. Both teams are trying to argue that each side is pressuring them into one option, meaning that it's forming an identity based onto only that idea, and it's pressuring them to only make this kind of idea. We think inherently of all natures, social narratives and societal environments make ideas and pushes people into a direction that certain options and decisions are certain things that we would rather clarify to be good. Therefore, both teams are basically arguing that narratives have either benefit or harm. So it's not necessarily about motherhood itself. In the end, what we think this debate is about, if we're going to have a societal atmosphere, what's rather more healthy in the sense that it rather gains comparatively more independence and liberty, therefore self-actualization to that woman, if we are going to make that woman think that one side of a decision is rather better for that person, and therefore in the end make a balanced out choice. Let's go on. First, about external support. I didn't mean to start there. Sit down. On the situation of ideas of external support, basically three ideas for opposition support. Number one, women are already in status quo powerless. They need help from institutions and organizations all over the place. Second, they need to feel good and happy about themselves when they are a mother. And third, they need recognition from the society. Let's go case by case. Number one, about being powerless and they need help from the institutions. It's meaningless even if you have external help from the institutions. I'm going to explain to you why you won't have that in the first place later on. But just in and of itself. If you are going to be binded onto a family, therefore, you don't have dependence on what kind of decisions that you can possibly make, and therefore, you're not going to necessarily have capacity to use these assets, what's the meaning of you having external help and subsidizations from the institutions anyways? In the end, they don't explain their impact of how this ever the most explains of why it's a benefit for these women in any sense. We think that's false, therefore. Second, about being feeling good, happiness, all this kind of stuff. I think opening government was pretty good enough by questioning what's true happiness, if it's your identity or not, but they kind of track themselves as well. In the end, what we rather say as closing government, in a comparison, if we're going to need to make them choose one decision, what's rather better in the end? If women are going to be continued into an atmosphere in a culture that they need to be mothers, we think that's why my member is important, because it continues the cycle of them continuously choosing one form of a lifestyle. In the end, if this perpetuates patriarchy and misogyny, and therefore antagonizes their unfair situation in a continuous, we think that's why they could rather be a comparative of why this is an unhealthy and therefore unhappy decision. Let's talk about this a bit more. This is about recognition. Let's talk about this point. What Upwrench in Total argues is that what this mainly does is people think that women are doing a grand job and we're giving recognition to them and somehow it's empowering. But they never really explain why this empowers women. What they mainly say is that we think women and mothers are doing a good job. What really is the situation, though, as we characterize, is misogyny and patriarchy. What rather happens is that maybe we can identify them as good mothers. But what does that really mean? In a sense that gender roles is impactful, that you now characterize that both men and women have different capacities, different roles that are inherently given, and therefore they do different jobs, is the source of misogyny and patriarchy. Yeah. Why? They think that what women do as a mother is something either easy or something less valuable compared to what men do, which is basically coming up with income, feeding the family, somehow becoming more powerful. Unlikely, which they would say, maybe they could be formed as a good mother. But does that really give true recognition in the end? No. Why? Because there's still the motherhood. There's still the gender role impactful woman at this situation, and therefore they're under a discriminatory factor. You didn't take my POA anyways. Sit down.
In a situation, therefore, what we rather think in a situation as a comparison is what happens under our side. You escape that gender role in the end. Why? As my partner already explained to you, going against motherhood in essence as a value already goes against gender role because you don't become the mother of that family. But more importantly, this is what becomes important. You become economically capable. Why? Basically being on motherhood, the culture that follows as that family is that they rather deprioritize the daughter for education because all what she needs to do anyways in the future compared to their son is being a mother. In essence, unfortunately, what happens is that they prioritize their limited amount of resources all to their son because the son is going to be the breadwinner in the end and the mother's just going to be the mother. No. In the end, what rather happens is that the independence that lacks from the woman, why? You don't be able to work outside as a society member. You're tagged and you're tamed to your family. This is the problem that opening wanted to talk about, but never really explained the mechanism, right? In the situation, what rather happens as a value is now going to be my last argument. At least what happens, even if we say that both sides are somehow pressuring women into a certain narrative, into certain ways of happiness, let's say that is the situation. If that, what's a rather preferable narrative that we would probably pursue as a society member? What we would rather have is that women are at least dependent on what decisions that they can make. As an economic member in a society, they can go for housing. They can go for a lawyer if domestic violence happens. Maybe they're going to be demonized that they aren't of other anyways. Or somehow, they're going to be pressured. But they make their own decisions. And they make their own defense because they have that economic capacity and they're not tamed to the gender role. We think that's much more of a preferable world, even if that's so. Why? Because you make your independent decisions, you make your own decisions, and you make self-actualization based onto your own characteristics, not tamed onto your family. In the end, what happens onto our side is that we try to take down the chain narratives of misogyny and gender roles. We think it's a step that we try to make in the change of society. Maybe it's going to gain criticism, we agree, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't try.
I think the government went for that speech and the case of opposition as well as the debate opposition was the case.
This is why we tell you it is okay for you to go with this narrative because in first world
countries in the first world context is likely for to have other narratives that is in competition with each other in those sanctions. But at the same time, we think in first world countries, women are more likely to have communities, to have circles to turn to. When they feel like they want to go in to have discussions that they claim, as they claim, with other types of women. When they feel like they need to have a change of context, need to have change of opinions over different issues or over motherhood, or the idea that they don't like motherhood in itself. We think it's more likely when they have competing narratives, it's more likely for to have communities and circles to have that discussion. But what is unique from closing opposition at that point? As I will tell you, it's more likely on our side to have opt-out mechanism for women who choose to be housewives, for women who choose to be mothers. This policy gives you agency over the choices you have made. It gives you moral agency over if your choice is a gender as a woman. But a lot of times, because of that, I mentioned to you, there are support systems existing. It's more likely for them to be able to say that I made this decision in the past, now I regret this decision. It's more likely, and it's a lot easier for them to return to other circles, other narratives, or other communities for support. But the thing to notice in comparison is under this clash is that without this narrative, other narratives in terms of patriarchy were a society more likely to favor women who are in households are hostile women, are either hostile women or similarly demeaning because they pose other burdens on women as well. If you claim that you should not be a housewife, if you claim that you should not have children, you should not conform to patriarchy, you are pushing women into leaning feminism and saying that you should be always to pursue a career of a CEO. Always, you should always be a career-driven woman. We don't think that's somehow better than pushing women into households and being housewives. They need to prove necessarily why that's a better narrative for the society to accept. No, thank you. But secondly, let's take a look at the context of underdeveloped or third world context. Why do we think our side is better, right? This is where the question is that we don't have mechanisms. But firstly, let's take a look at what the countries look like. We think usually in those countries with high level of patriarchy, of course, you have like the fact that women in household or women being mothers are being celebrated. It means that, firstly, given this particular narrative, you create a glorifying narrative that credits women for the things that they have done and for the labor they have been putting in. It means that you consolidate women or mothers in household and give them power and status at household. Why is this important, right? We tell you this is how women in patriarchy or in conservative societies bargain for power and economic abilities. I think it's a lot unlikely, no thank you, for you to imagine in extremely conservative society or patriarchy, women suddenly stand up and say, I'm now going to be housewife, I'm going to leave home, I'm going to be somehow economically successful because I reject the notion of motherhood as a fulfilling narrative. And this is just a false imagination coming from government bench. But lastly, why do I think that, no thank you. They argue to you that you want ground movements to happen. They argue to you that you want more education of women, more collective action in conservative society. We think it's more likely under opposition side. Why is that? We tell you a lot of times ground movements happen in conservative society in a very insidious way, right? You don't have households, you don't have mothers in households collectively stand up against their husbands and say we want to be feminist. A lot of times you need to be able to firstly say that you have some status within households, you have some bargaining power with your husband or with your family, with the exact patriarchy that is pushing you. No thank you. This is the moment that you're able to say women who are seeking career possibly can have more discussion over what are the futures for them. We think on their side, they are taking away the likability because they're taking away source of credit that you give women in conservative society. Comparatively under our side, we have more likelihood to initiate the particular type of change that of government bench has been pushing forward. So let's take a look at particular harms that they try to push forward. No, thank you. First, they say women are compelled to make sacrifices. They say there's a psychological trauma, and they say domestic abuses are extremely important. We agree, but the question is, a lot of times, when you make sacrifices to children, you're making sacrifices for the people that you love. We don't think that's extremely illegitimate. Under their unrealistic portrayal, all the women who are taking care of the children, all the women who are taking care of the family, are ones making wrong decisions and illegitimate decisions. We don't think that's the right description of the status quo. But secondly, a lot of times, if you are severely traumatized by the fact that you are being a mother, possibly you should go to a doctor. This is not really the burden of proof under opposition bench. But at the same time, we think this is also imagining or imposing moral standards on women as well. Because you're telling women it is wrong or it is immoral for you to make that particular decision for yourself. We don't see I don't think it's fair for you to push women into that decision without providing them with means to achieve other things in conservative or patriarchal society. Even in first world countries, we argue with you, it's unlikely for you to say that I am going to be economically successful the moment when I decide that this is wrong, the moment when others tell you that you should opt out of the family and you should become a career woman. We think opposition gives you better analysis on that. First, but lastly, okay, no lastly. Thank you very much.